Ethiopia, the land of our fathers, the land where the gods love to be. As storm cloud at night suddenly gathers, our armies come rushing to thee.
We must in the fight be victorious, when swords are thrust outward to thee. For us will the victory be glorious, when led by the red, black, and green. Advance, advance to victory, let Africa be free.
Advance,
advance to meet the foe.
Advance,
advance to meet the foe. With the might of the red, the black, and the green. With the might of the red, the black, and the green.
Ethiopia, the tyrant's falling, who smote thee upon thy knees, and thy children are lustily called from over the distant seas. Jehovah, the great one, has heard us, has noted our sighs and our tears. With the spirit of love, he has stirred us to be one through the coming years.
Advance, advance to victory, let Africa be free.
Advance,
advance to meet the foe.
Advance,
advance to meet the foe. With the might of the red, the black, and the green. With the might of the red, the black, and the green. O Jehovah, thou God of grant unto our sons that lead the wisdom thou gave to thy sages when Israel was sore in need.
Thy voice in the dim past has spoken. Ethiopia shall stretch forth hand.
By thee shall our fetters be broken, and heaven bless our dear fatherland. Advance, advance to victory, let Africa be free.
Advance,
advance to meet the foe.
Advance,
advance to meet the foe. With the might of the red, the black, and the green. With the might of the red, the black, and the green.
Ever so often, a spirit leaves or ruins the home of the ancestors and come to earth, a spirit that is larger than life. A spirit who leaves a legacy behind and who charters a course that we must follow. Ibashe, Marcus Mosiah Garvey. Ibashe. And as we are here at this Queen's Park Steel Shed, at this, my brothers, I'm hoping, and the sisters in the audience, that somewhere along the lines, we get to change the name from Queen's Park to whatever else. This Mosiah, who would have impacted on the entire world, made the pilgrimage to this sacred land, Barbados. And indeed, would have spoken at our Queen's Park Steel Shed right here in Queen's Park. And he would have said words of revolution to our people, and he would have impacted on our people just like he would have impacted on the entire world. This man, this Messiah, this Marcus Mosiah Garvey. We would have had many people who would have gone on to make strides in relation to developing this country. None other than Errol Walton Barron, Ibashe. Clement Payne, Ibashe. Israel Lovell, Ibashe. Charles Duncan O'Neill, Ibashe. Ulrich Grant, Ibashe. Menzies Case, and all the others too numerous to mention. And I know that they had some women in there too, but unfortunately, we don't pay much attention to the women because our history was taught to us by the Europeans. Pangina Gibbs, Ibashe, 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 Ibashe. Give thanks for the legacy of Marcus Mosiah Garvey and the ones he would have influenced. It was him who would have brought us to this juncture. I look back on the life of Marcus Mosiah Garvey and I try to compare it to our lives. The man who would have left that legacy, the man who would have passed on the baton. And I said, did we do enough? Or did we drop that baton? Too often we argue about frivolousness. Marcus Garvey had the ships, had the nurses, has everything in place. And we are still lagging behind. Ibashe, Ibashe. Wali in gung gung wali yo. Wali in gung gung wali yo. Wali in gung gung wali yo. Wallyingungung wallyo, wallyingungung wallyo, wallyingungung wallyo. Ashe, ashe, ashe. Wallyingungung wallyo, wallyingungung wallyo. Wallyingungung wallyo, wallyingungung wallyo, wallyingungung wallyo.
Pleasant good evening. Senator, Mr. John Kingston, Government Special Advisor on Culture and Heritage, members of the Diplomatic Corps, members of the Board of the National Cultural Foundation, Mrs. Carol Roberts-Reefer, Chief Executive Officer, and other members of staff of the National Cultural Foundation, Dr. Rodney Worrell, lecturer at UWA and our featured speaker for this evening, members of the Pan-African Movement, the Honorable Trevor Prescott, Special Envoy on Reparations and Economic Enfranchisement in the Prime Minister's Office, persons watching online, specially invited guests. God had given them minds with which to rule and to regulate the world. If they prayed because they were not getting enough out of the world, their prayers would not avail them much. But if they prayed for intelligence and confidence in themselves, they would receive more than they could desire. Why should they take God for an employment agent? God did not build cities. Of all the beautiful cities in the world, man was the architect. The words of Marcus Messiah Garvey. Good evening again, and my name is Rodney Grant, Chairman of the Barbados Intangible Cultural Heritage Committee, and I am your host for this evening. As Barbados continues to celebrate the season of emancipation, the Prime Minister's Office, Culture, and the National Cultural Foundation are commemorating the life and times of the Jamaican Pan-Africanist Marcus Garvey at this historic location, Queen's Park. Queen's Park holds great significance to the Marcus Garvey Day, since it was at the Queen's Park Steel Shed, where he delivered a powerful lecture to hundreds of his supporters entitled Intelligence versus Ignorance. In the early hours of October the 18th, 1937, leader of the Pan-Africanist Movement and President General of the Universal Negro Improvement Association, Marcus Garvey sailed into Barbados on the CNS Lady Nelson. Thousands of black Barbadians gathered at the pierhead to glimpse the revolutionary Pan-Africanist from St. Anne, Jamaica. Garvey was greeted by several dignitaries from the local UNIA branches and the local business sector. This evening, the Prime Minister's Office, Culture, and the NCF has produced this event to highlight Jamaicans Marcus Garvey's influence on the development of Pan-Africanism in Barbados and the wider Barbadian society in general during the 20th century and the first two decades of the 21st century. Ladies and gentlemen, before we get into the main event, I want to introduce to you Damien Damani Reed. He's a Barbadian spoken word artist and poet. Having a keen interest in the lyricism and performance, Damani Ree began his artistic career as a conscious rapper during his college years, but was soon drawn into the world of spoken word and poetry. His newfound love for the art form led him to compete in a talent competition at the Hilton Hotel, and he won with his piece entitled Emancipation. Today, Emancipation remains one of the most popular pieces with its biting commentary on matters of liberation of people of the African diaspora in Barbados. Damani Ree is twice a winner of Star Search and a 2013 NIFCA Bronze Awardee. We now have the pleasure of inviting Damani Ree to perform a piece entitled Black Castor Oil. Black Castor Oil, and he's supported by Raheem Waldrum on the djembe drums. Thank you very much.
Black castor oil, masters of the soil, forecasters of the future. The doulas, babalows, riding heaven clothes to bring forth showers of blessings. The djembe boss drummer, covered in kente cloth, beating and chanting that rhythmic kumtuma. Never leave ma. Forever ifa. Bush teas that never favor fevers. Burning sage, leave aroma, putting evil spirits in a coma. The black persona. Black castor oil, organic and unspoiled. Put it in the hair to strengthen the roots. Sleeping in the crown chakra, unshackling the truth like Shaka Zulu and his troops. Shielding the culture from foreign invaders, tomb raiders, and naysayers. We some revolutionary game changers. Filmmakers, all black cast, black castrol. They cannot place an embargo on our embryos. Our children will grow to be griots, telling the story of African glory. Celebration of heroes that bleed red, gold, and green by any means necessary. One God, one aim, one destiny. From the continent to the Caribbean, that dream is manifesting. Black castor oil, massaging the joints of the disjointed. We are our own saviors anointed. Establishing phases of the moon. They desecrated our tombs, but they cannot desecrate our greatness. Artists? Nah! Sages on stages, resurrecting papyrus pages, true speech. The black castor oil, you too. Damn. Sweet. Whether famous, blacklisted, or nameless. One fact is, every stroke of the brush, hammer, chisel, or whatchamacallit, gadget, impact, this, your world changes. My world changes. Our world changes. black castor oil. Carvers of your own future, masters of your own peace. The black castor oil, you too. Down, deep.
God never justified wealth or poverty. Men did that themselves. He never made a thief or a liar. Every man made himself to suit himself as far as his character went. Marcus Messiah Garvey. Dr. Rodney Worrell is a lecturer in the Department of History and Philosophy at the University of the West Indies, Give Hill Campus. He has written extensively on Pan-Africanism. His latest book is George Padmore's Black Internationalism. This evening's feature speaker will present on Marcus Messiah Garvey, the Jamaican-born Pan-Africanist, who was a major influence on the development of Pan-Africanism in Barbados and the wider Barbadian society in general during the 20th century and the first two decades of the 21st century. Many of the outstanding political and labor leaders in the 1920s and 30s were followers of Garvey, including Charles Duncan O'Neill, Israel Lovell, John Beckles, Clennon Wickham, Alexandrina Gibbs, Ruth Manning, Frederick Small, Ulrich Grant, and Clement Paine. Although Garvey died in 1940, his ideas continue to resonate with the Barbadian people, politicians, governments, Rastafarians, and the Pan-African formations that emerged in the second half of the 20th century and the early 21st century. The Black Power movement witnessed a restatement of Garvey's core ideas. Ladies and gentlemen, to deliver the feature lecture, Marcus Garvey's Impact on the Barbadian Landscape, 1919 to 2019, Dr. Rodney Worrell.
Thank you. Thank you. Senator John King, members of the Diplomatic Corps, CEO of the National Cultural Foundation, Carol Roberts Reefer, MP Trevor Prescott, Special Envoy on Reparations and Affirmative Action. Comrades, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, I wish to thank the National Cultural Foundation for hosting this event. Similar type events like this one is being held all over the world. Earlier, I was approached to sit on two panel discussions commemorating the 135th anniversary of the birth of Marcus Garvey. And not only because of the current moment, but Garveyites or Pan-Africanists in Barbados in the 20s and 30s used to commemorate the birthday of Marcus Garvey. In fact, August, today August is special in the United States. We talk about Black August. But August was special inside of Barbados because the 1st of August was Emancipation Day. The 17th was Garvey's birthday. And the 31st was supposed to be a public holiday given the declaration of the peoples that was presented in 1920 at Garvey's important people's conference. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me. Somehow you took a chance in inviting me. So I hope that I don't let you down. Yeah, I wish to thank Sister Michelle Springer for reaching out to me. And I also want to thank Stacey O'Brien for doing an excellent job in selling this event. Before I begin my address, however, I want to call on the name of Kofi Akobi, my president and general secretary within the Pan-African Movement, and also my mentor and advisor. And I can see Brother Kofi looking down at me as I'm about to ground with the people. Hopefully, sometime in the future, I can have a more fulsome discourse on the outstanding contribution of Kofi Akobi to Pan-Africanism inside of Barbados. Long live my brother. Long live Kofi Akobi. This talk is very ambitious, and I don't intend to take you through a very long discourse. I prefer to have engagement in terms of questions. But I want to speak about some of Garvey's ideas and his political praxis, because these ideas not only resonated with Barbadians, with Pan-Africanists, but they transcended Pan-Africanism, and they also transcended generations as well. So we can still see some of the relevance of some of Garvey's ideas, and his ideas had a major impact. And I begin my talk 1919, which was when you had the creation of the first UNIA movement in Barbados. The Honorable Marcus Mosiah Garvey, who is a national hero of Jamaica, a prophet to some Rastafarians, member of the Trinity by another section of Rastafarians, de facto national hero of the masses of Caribbean people, was the most important West Indian in the 20th century. Garvey provided hope and inspirations for persons of African descent who were really in the pits of economic, psychological, political degradation because they were part of a brutal, exploitative capitalist system, a brutal, exploitative colonial system. And Garvey, after extensive travels, came to the harsh realization that black people were at the bottom of the socioeconomic ladder in Latin America, the Caribbean, in Europe, and in North America. But Garvey, instead of wallowing in pity and defeatism, decided to create an entity that would be the instrument for redressing these disabilities facing the African people, and this is when he created the Universal Negro Improvement Association and African Community Leagues. Well, later on, we just speak about the UNIA because the ACL, right, was not utilized a lot after. And Garvey recognized that if the race was oppressed on racial grounds because of the racist capitalist system, therefore, any program of liberation must begin with race first, and it must be buttressed by self-reliance and racial pride. And after Garvey migrated to the United States, and I'm going over a lot of things that you already know, but as a teacher, I don't take things for granted. So just a bit of revision. It was in the United States that the UNIA started to explode after the first great European war. And after the first great European war, war witnessed a resurgence of racism inside the United States of America. We're living in such a moment now. But this resurgence of racism was fueled by the Klan. It was manifested in the Red Summer of 1919, where you had over 25 race riots taking place in the United States. It was brought about because of hardship emerging as a result of the Great War, increase in the cost of living, etc. But this was also a period where the roots of colonialism was shaken with the coming on stream or the successful Russian or the Bolshevik Revolution. Branches of the UNIA were established in over 40 countries, maybe 41 countries. Therefore, the UNIA was the largest Pan-African organization, and it was also the largest Pan-Caribbean organization. Not to be left out, the first branch of the UNIA was formed in Barbados in 1919, and I suspect, haven't seen the any document suggesting a precise date. One can safely speculate that it was sometime late in 1919. And this branch was the Reed Street, Tudor Street branch, number 40. And number 40 would give you some idea that it was one of the early branches. Because when the second branch was formed, the Westbury branch number formed in 1920, the number was 229. So this gives an indication of the explosion of Garveyite branches across the world. And John Beckles, the owner of the Black Cat Laundry, who played a major role in this organization, he became the president of this entity. And some of the leading members were people like Clennon Wickham, Harold Wilson, who not only was a leading Garveyite in Barbados, but he became a leading Garveyite in Antigua, and he was also the only Barbadian that attended the 1920 People's Conference. J.T. Ramsey, he was also one of the important members of this entity. And unlike the earlier historians, my sister Andrea, I will call the name of four important women: Lolita Smitten, Christina Aline, Ottie Carrington, Alonzi Alkins. And these were four teachers who taught in the Garvey Night School put on by the Reed Street, Tudor Street branch of the UNIA. Also, I will mention the name of Aldika Griffith, who was one of the trustees of this school as well. So women, and I wrote an article on women in the Garveyite movement in Barbados, so hopefully it will come out sometime and we will see that women did play important roles inside of this branch as well. A second branch, and this second branch was the West Barry branch, which was formed early in 1920. This branch was led by Israel Lovell and some of the other outstanding members of this branch: John Catwell, Melvin Innes, John Allen, Alexandrina Gibbs, who emerged as not only the leading female ideologue, but she was one of the leading ideologues of this branch as well. So I'm glad that David did mention Alexandrina Gibbs when John was performing the libations. Now, the Westbury branch was responsible for the initial invitation when Garvey visited in October 1937. And when Garvey came as well, because by this time, the Reed Street, Tudor Street branch stopped functioning in the mid-1920s. It was the Westbury branch that was still functioning, and Garvey went to the Liberty Hall, where he was given a guard of honor by members of the landship, and I was expecting the members of the landship to give me that honor. However, a lot of Garveyites had gone into the landship movement in the 1930s. Other UNIA branches, Half Moon Fort, Crab Hill, recently I saw a document that suggested that a branch was in Spikestown. John Allen said that he used to go to places, Spikestown and other places, where branches were located, and there would get back home 2 to 3 o'clock in the morning. They used to ride a donkey. And he also said that some of these branches became inactive because they were unable to visit them and give them support. Now, it was relatively easy to create a UNIA branch. 7 individuals of liberal education could apply, organize themselves, apply to the headquarters, and they would get the necessary charter. But very little is known of these branches. And it would be remiss of me if I did not mention There was a Garveyite branch formed in Barbados in 1987. And this branch was formed as part of the celebration of the 100th anniversary of Garvey's birthday. And this branch was formed by Martin Cadogan, the staunch Garveyite, former member of Carlos Cook's African Nationalist Pioneer Movement. He was the president. And the other members were Viola Davis, Trevor Marshall, and Olu Walren. So we can see that the Garvey branches, in this case, with the 1987 branch, transcended or went beyond the period that Garvey was alive. Now, the Working Men's Association was a Garvey organization as well. Although it was not a UNIA branch, it was a Garvey organization. And in saying this, I will demonstrate to you why it was a Garvey organization. Dr. Charles Duncan O'Neill, the patron saint of the Working Men's Association, became a Garveyite when he was in Trinidad, and he sought to pattern the Working Men's Association on the Trinidad Working Men's Association. But at the time, the Trinidad Working Men's Association philosophy was rooted in Fabian socialism and in Pan-Africanism, with many of the Garveyites playing leading roles within the organization. And O'Neill said that while it was not Garvey movement in the true sense, he said it was inspired by Garvey. So at their meetings, they would read from Garvey's newspaper, and they would also sing the Red Anthem. So they practiced Pan-Africanism and Fabian socialism as well. If you look at the economic principles of the Working Men's Association as well, we can clearly see that it was based on Garvey's cooperative economics. Because O'Neill said what was uppermost in their minds when they created this entity was that it would be modeled along Garvey's lines, and they hoped that they would reach, evolve, develop to the stage where they would be able to build their own factories. So they're talking about building their own sugar factories where they would grind their own cane. And part of the thinking was that they helped to make white businesses successful, the Costas, Harrison's, the Ideal Store, etc. And the thinking was that they needed to make black businesses successful as well, where these black businesses would hire black people. Out of the Working Men's Association was the Barbados Workers Union Cooperative Company. And the Working Men's Loans and Friendly Investment Society. Out of this entity, they had a store and a pharmacy on the corner of Reed Street and Bastards Road. But what was important about this pharmacy, that it was written in bold letters, owned by the workers, managed by the workers, for the benefit of the workers. Unfortunately, this store collapsed after a few years. So I hope that I demonstrated that the Workers' Men's Association was a Garveyite entity. Now, the decision to become a Garveyite was not the easiest decision in the world. It was the obvious one, but it was not the easiest one. And I said it was not the easiest one because of the level of repression that was meted out to the Garveyites, those who were strong enough, those who were bold enough, right? They joined these entities with a sense of pride, right? The colonial authorities tried to stymie the Garveyite movement in Barbados because it was viewed as a threat to the existing status quo. For example, the authorities tried to pass a seditious publication ordinance, so they wanted to curb or take pot shots. This was maybe a step before they banned the Negro World. The police constantly monitored the meetings, constantly harassed the Garveyites. O'Neill complained that the police were using every method to destroy them. It was said that persons were paid a princely sum of $200. And if you think about $200 in the 1920s, this was a princely sum to go and join the Workers' Men's Association, etc., and to destroy the movement from inside. In April 1928, right, and we talk about Garvey coming in 37, but before we get there, in 1928, the authorities refused to let Garvey land inside of Barbados. In 1927 March, they passed the undesirable, I think the expulsion of the undesirables act in 1927. And when they heard that, when the Garveyites heard that Garvey was coming to Barbados, they were all excited and they were formulating all of these plans to see their leader. Unfortunately, these plans were dashed. When they heard that Garvey was going to be on a ship and he could not come into the port, their plan to hire boats and go and abandon work and, yes, celebrate with Garvey, but this did not happen. The Inspector General of the Police, he wrote the Colonial Secretary, instructing the, or telling the Colonial Secretary, it would not be advisable to allow Garvey to come to Barbados, and they should inform the Jamaican authorities as well. Garvey stopped in transit in 1928, November, but he was not allowed to come on the island. But Garvey was extremely peeved to the point where he wrote a letter, he wrote a petition to the League of Nations, and he complained that the governor of Barbados wrote to the governor of another country asking him not to issue a passport to a certain influential black man who had contemplated visiting Barbados to confer with the poor people of the island relative to some means of improving themselves. As Brother Grant said earlier, Garvey did finally get permission in 1937 to visit Barbados. By 1937, however, Garvey was no longer the threat that he was a decade before. The UNIA movement internationally was very much in decline. The UNIA movement locally was very much in decline. And this was also, while there was a lot of excitement in the fact that the working people wanted to see Garvey, this was tinged because some of the working people, the Garveyites, were in prison. And this was the period of the October Assizes. So the Israel Lovells and the Ulrich Grants, many of the labor leaders and also Garveyites who participated in the labor struggles, they were unable to share the joy of seeing Marcus Garvey inside the flesh. But Garvey was still popular on the island, as was manifested by the thousands of Barbadians who gathered at all vantage points to take a look at the great Marcus Garvey. It was said when Marcia Burroughs was telling me that when the vehicle that Garvey was traveling and went down Bay Street, hundreds of persons were just running behind this vehicle. And Garvey did deliver a lecture in Queen's Park Steel Shed. A huge lecture. In fact, it was said to be one of the largest crowds, assembled inside of Queen's Park. But also, and I believe not just the lecture, but there was a luncheon as well. The luncheon was at Queen's Park House. This luncheon was significant because John Beckles was asked to raise the first toast. And John Beckles said that the Garveyites were yearning for this moment for many years. And Hilton Vaughan, who also raised a toast as well, he said that Garvey's aims and thoughts had been misconstrued. And the day will surely come when his endeavors would be appreciated. Now, the UNIA and the Working Men's Association sought to instill pride in their members to raise their self-esteem, and easily the most racist territory inside the Caribbean. Right? The Bees had the dubious distinction, Barbados, Bahamas, and Bermuda. And if you don't believe me, even down to the 1950s, when there was a discussion about having Barbados as the site or the capital of the West Indian Federation, right? People were still saying that Barbados, no, we can't locate the Federation in Barbados because it is very racist, right? Good. Now, so Garvey instilled in his followers that they had the same, that they were equal to whites. And this was very much evident in the language of the Garveyites, who now went around seeing a black skin no longer as a badge of shame, but they saw this as a badge of pride. And they were saying that they have the same five senses of whites. Now, when Clement Paine came to Barbados in 1937, right, he did mention that he still saw that some Barbadians had this inferiority fixation. And this was evident in the way that they interface with white people. And he counseled them to speak to whites in the same manner that he spoke to the colonial secretary as well. And if we move to the period of black power era in the late 60s, early 1970s, Elombe Motley, who was one of the major black power figures in Black Night, he was telling Barbadians to re-evaluate the misrepresentations about themselves. Right? So this is really a restatement of what Garvey had said many years ago. And Elombe said, for example, that, yeah, they were now to see themselves as black and beautiful and kinky here is good. The Rastafarians, however, didn't have this problem because from the inception, the Rastafarians have always asserted black is beautiful and kinky hair was now a crown of glory. So they didn't have this problem. And the racism, still talking about this racism, was playing out itself in fairly contradictory positions as well. On the one hand, blacks felt that they were the equal to whites, but even down to the late 80s, early 90s, and I hope it is no longer there, there was this perception that somehow that whites were innately better businessmen than blacks. And this came to a head with the struggle for the mutual affair, and Professor Beckles, Walter Ramsey, David Comichon, and members of the Busser Committee. I'm hopeful that they put that to rest once and for all. But this was still this contradiction going on there. Right. Garvey wanted to liberate Africa from the clutches of European colonialism, European imperialism. He wanted to see the construction of a strong African nation or united African nation that would be the custodian of all black people. Garvey pre-occupation was rooted in the Pan-Africanist tradition that he was now a part of. In July 1920, Garvey wrote a letter to the Garveyites in Barbados where he told them that he was going to relocate his headquarters after the People's Conference of 1920. But the Liberian government refused to grant Garvey permission to relocate his headquarters. But notwithstanding this setback, the Garveyites in Barbados continue to express their desire to repatriate to Africa, or some of them talk about visiting Africa. In the early 1930s, discussion was rife in Barbados about sending some Barbadians to British Guyana to alleviate the high levels of unemployment in Barbados. But the Garveyites were clear. The only place that we want to be relocated is to Liberia. Right, they said, yeah, one John Hawkins brought us to the Caribbean, another John Hawkins, this is the racist one now, wanted to take them from Barbados, but they wanted to go back, or they wanted to go to Africa. And Garvey's ideas were repeated by D.D. Garner in the 1950s. D.D. Garner was a representative from St. Philip, and his phraseology and ideology was very much smart of a Garveyite in the 20s and the 30s. It's remarkable reading. some of his thoughts. For example, he was saying that the discussion about getting Barbadians to go abroad and work in North America, and he was of the view that we should be trying to get some of these people to go and work in Africa. So D.D. Garner echoed the sentiments of Garvey. And again, I must compliment, or I must mention that repatriation was, and I believe still is, one of the staples of the Rastafarians. And when we think about the assistance that Barbadians give to the anti-apartheid movement in Southern Africa, right, it is clearly that this was influenced by Garvey's desire not only to see the Europeans, but it was also out of Africa, but it was also rooted in this unity in the struggle and the need for a strong, united Africa that would be the custodians of Africans at home and those abroad. And these calls were calls for closer links, closer cooperation, were echoed by the climate pain movement, the Pan-African Movement of Barbados, the Marcus Garvey 100th Anniversary Committee. So we can clearly see the evidence of Garveyism inside of these calls. In fact, the establishment of embassies in Ghana and Kenya, as well as the desire to trade and foster air links and direct links with Africa. Right? When Garvey was formulating his Black Star Line, right, this was Garvey had a conception of Pan-African trade, right? Trade between the diaspora, trade among the diaspora, and trade among the diaspora and Africa. So in a sense, this is very much part of the Garvey's thinking. History, and I'll wrap up shortly, right? For Garvey, history was a tool for fostering Black pride and emancipation. And Garvey talked about canonizing our saints, create our martyrs, etc. Pain, in the 1930s, criticized the Eurocentric nature of the colonial curriculum and called for the teaching of our Black poets and our Black philosophers. In particular, he mentioned Mary Shaw, the Pan-Africanist from Grenada, and our own Clinel Wickham. This was also echoed in 1969 when Leroy Haywood wrote his small work on Black powerlessness in Barbados. He talked the only way that Leroy talked about Black children are drug senseless, with European history or a distorted history written by prejudicial Europeans. Now, we can say with the advent of CXC, this is no longer the case, as the content is more reflective of the Caribbean realities. The challenge, however, is that insufficient number of students are pursuing history and literature. The canonization of our heroes is also rooted in this call for national heroes. 1936, Lovell is saying that he's calling for a permanent monument for Duncan O'Neill. And anybody who studied Barbados in the 1920s and the 1930s would know that O'Neill was a national hero. A historian didn't have to go and do any research and tell people this. The people knew that Charles Duncan O'Neill was a national hero. And to Lovell and the disciples of O'Neill, this is why Lovell could call for O'Neill for a permanent monument for O'Neill in 1936. This is why Lovell could call for, or who made the bold statement that Samuel Jackman Prescott was the only politician in the history of Parliament up to that period who did anything good for his people. And this is why in 1966 that Calvin Allen, who was the General Secretary of the People's Progressive Movement, could call for the statue of Lord Nelson to be removed and replaced by Samuel Jackman Prescott. And this is why the PPM made the call for the tearing down of these imperialist statues and renaming the streets. And these sentiments were echoed by Black Knight as well, out of the Bassa Awards, the Bassa Committee as well. The sense that, the Bassa name was popularized, and we knew. We didn't have to wait for the historians to tell us these things, that Bassa was a national hero, because as a Garveyite, we talk about the martyrs. And this is why in the later on, David Commission and the Clement Payne Union consistently lobbied for Clement Payne and the heroes of the labor rebellions of 1937 to become national heroes. I can go on, but I will say that if you look at the labor activism on the island, right, this labor activism was fueled. The industrial ferment of the 1920s was fueled by the Garveyites, and the Garveyites were clear that the people should be properly compensated. And we're talking about a period of brutal exploitation. Hence, we're talking about the Workers' Men's Association. And this is not a real trade union. And I say not a real trade union because trade unions were illegal. And we only have to cast our minds to the ill-fated dock workers' strike of 1927. But the workers' minds were still in the vanguard of labor agitation. And when the West Indian Commission came to Barbados in 1929, they sought to be the de facto representatives of workers, presenting a memorandum with the grievances of the agricultural workers. And Frederick Small, Louis Sabro, and Ruth Manning addressed the commission at the public hearings. And Ruth Manning was very practical, and she said, the reason for this widespread starvation in Barbados is because of the poor wages being paid to the workers. She also talked about a wicked practice where the planters, especially in some of the rural spaces, would come to town for the money on Fridays and remain in town gambling and having fun. And workers were paid 9 o'clock on Saturday nights and all of these kinds of things. So we're talking about some real terrible practices that were inflicted on working people. And after Garvey launched his political party in Jamaica, this led the Workers' Men's Association to form the Barbados Workers Political Club with the intention to get more blacks in the House of Assembly. So in 1929, I think there was one black person, Chrissy Braffitt. by 1930. There were four black persons. So Lavelle, for example, said that, you know, for many years, those of you that had the franchise voted for white people. Now is the opportunity to vote for black people. Fortunately, O'Neill had to wait until 1932 before he was elected. And in closing, I will mention that if you're talking about a black theology, right, Garvey's idea of a black God is still manifested, right, in the beliefs of the Rastafarians and others from the African syncretic faiths, spiritual Baptists, etc. So I will close by saying that Marcus Garvey made a significant contribution to Pan-Africanism on the island. His influence transcended Pan-Africanism and encompassed all facets of Barbadian society and several generations of Barbadians. One God, one aim, one destiny. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Worrell. I want to acknowledge the presence of Senator Dr. the Honorable Chantal Morrow Knight, Minister in the Prime Minister's Office with Responsibility for Culture. Welcome, ma'am. You know, if you see me with my phone, I don't know how many people are in the same position that I am. You know, I have a watch, or two or three watches, and I don't think any of them actually tell time. You know, most of us now use our phones to keep track of time, you know. So if you see me with my phone, it's because I'm keeping track of the time on my phone. My watch is saying something to 9. Right. So this is the time now where we want to pose a few questions to Dr. Worrell. There are two mics which we encourage you to use for the purposes of the live stream so that we can get the feed into the cameras. So the floor is open to you. You just raise your hand and they think they're ushers to move around, to move the mics around. Here at the front.
Oh, I'm Ambassador sorry. Commission. I thought that you were dealing with the microphones at the side. I'm standing, so I didn't want to go sit back down.
Oh, again. Well, go ahead.
Yeah, okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah, my name is Art Edwards, and I share one thing with Marcus Garvey. And as I was in boarding school for 7 years, a boarding school that had, 85% white people, and only me and a few, including Astafan, who is now a regional figure, apparently. He was the head of the so-called Black Power movement within that boarding school. But Marcus Garvey grew up in a white neighborhood, I believe. Is that not true? He grew up with white neighbors and stuff, and he played with white children and that kind of thing.
Girl.
And then, and at a certain age, he realized that he couldn't speak to them anymore because, of course, he was becoming more mature. But it's because of that upbringing that he had really no fear of white people. So he had an advantage. I don't really fear white people either, to be honest with you. But I'll say this much. We have a wax museum in Bridgetown with a depiction of Marcus Garvey that we have tried to get as accurate as possible. No, it has not been recognized until I've come to say this. It's there. And I would like to formally ask you, in the presence of the minister, thankfully she's here, nice to know you, to take a photo opportunity tomorrow. You tell me when you come in, you ain't gonna pay. All right, I will pay for you. Take the photo opportunity next to Marcus Garvey, and you tell me that I've made a mistake, because David saw it, Mr. Ambassador Commissar, and he said his cheeks ain't fat enough. We would rather do things that are complimenting as opposed to make a mistake on the wrong side of the fence. So you come and tell me it don't look right. And if it don't look right, I will change it just because you say so. You tell me the time, I think Mr. Grant will give you a number, and we could work this thing out tomorrow. You and me got a deal? Thank you.
Okay.
You want to respond or you want to take another question?
No, go ahead.
Ambassador, I think you may have to move to the mic. I think I had assumed there were people moving them around.
Good evening. Thank you, Rodney, for that lecture. And thank you for all the work you are doing to add to our understanding of Pan-Africanism in Barbados, to understanding more about Israel Lovell and the other working class Garveyites within Barbados. Just before I get into what I, the comment I wish to make, I just want to clear up that little piece of myth-making. Marcus Garvey did not grow up in a white neighborhood. Marcus Garvey was born and grew up in St. Anne's Bay in Jamaica. He came from peasant and artisanal stock. In fact, the foundation of his self-confidence and his sense of self-worth came out of that peasant and artisanal, that independent artisanal tradition. In fact, he was taught by his godfather the skills of printing. He became an expert printer, and that had a lot to do with his success as a journalist, as a printer of the Negro world and the black man, and so forth. He did speak about having one white girl as a friend that he interacted with as a child. But anyhow, I don't so much want to ask a question, Rodney, as to just to make a comment. You would know that last year I published this book, The Pan-African Love Story of Arnold and Mignon Ford. And I just want to record the fact that it was said that the personality who was second only to Garvey as the public face of the Universal Negro Improvement Association was Rabbi Arnold Josiah Ford, a Barbadian who was born in Barbados in 1877, and who became the musical director of the UNIA. But not just the musical director, because Arnold Ford had enlisted in the British Navy, so he had had a military training. And because of that military background, it was he who, in a sense, took control of the organizing of Garvey's paramilitary forces. It was he who wrote the regulations for the Garvey's Legion and so forth. Also, his wife, his Barbadian wife, Mignon Innes Ford, a very outstanding Garveyite as well. She migrated to Harlem in the 1920s and became a member of the Harlem branch of the UNIA, where she met Arnold, and she eventually followed Arnold to Ethiopia. And they became, in fact, Arnold accomplished what Garvey was unable to accomplish. Arnold actually led a Back to Africa repatriation movement to Ethiopia. So I just want to say that when we are looking at Garveyism in Barbados, that I want us to look as well at the Barbadians who, admittedly outside of Barbados, but Barbadians who made a very important contribution to the Marcus Garvey movement. Thank you very much.
Any other questions for Dr. Worrell?
Look, Ron.
Mm-hmm.
Blessings, family, blessings, blessings, blessings be multiplied. Dr. Worrell, we salute you. And I think it is very important that our scholars be on the right path of history. And not only when it is popular, but sometimes when it is unpopular, to say the things that needs to be said for the advancement of African people here in Barbados. We just commemorated the People's Uprising 1937 in Golden Square. Visiting my family was a young family from Guadeloupe. And when she heard Mia speak, she began to cry. Because she said that she longed for the day when Guadeloupe can have a prime minister speaking as such. Because today, Guadeloupe is still a colony of France. In the presentation, I was truly amazed to see the amount of traffic and business being conducted on Roebuck Street. And today, Roebuck Street is as a ghost town. We are majority blacks within this country, 95%, yet we still function as a minority. Dr. Worrell, sir, what realistically can be done to change this?
A political question.
Yeah. That is a big question.
You want to attempt a response?
Yeah. It is a big question. If I had the answer, I probably would be a millionaire. So I no need to come in here and give this little talk. But we're talking about, when we think about colonialism and the 300 and how many years and still this colonial enterprise, and we look at the damage psychologically to the people, and we look at the colonial structures that are still very much there. Yeah, well, we're not talking about something that can be knocked down tomorrow. Right? This is an ongoing struggle. And this is why persons like yourself and others of like mind, right, have to continue to, and don't be defeated. Because Garvey encountered a very wretched period, you know, when Garvey came. This was a low point, one of the lowest points, right, in the history of black people in the early 20th century. So I'm saying all of this to say that we can't be self-defeatist. We have to be optimistic, and we had a saying within the Pan-African movement that, yeah, we just can't agonize, but we must organize and continue to struggle. That is the only way to bring about this change.
Thank you very much. I see we have Special Envoy and Buddy. Buddy, you want to go first? I think you had your hand up first, and then we come to Special Envoy.
Thank you very much, Dr. Worrell, for excellent presentation. I was gripped with how erudite you are with the names and the events that take us through that whole period from the 1920s to the present. I want to add to the question that was asked by Reverend Umphrey Wells. And I listened to what the Prime Minister said. This is building up to the question. What the Prime Minister said on the 26th of July at the Golden Square event, she said that the 1661 Slave Code Act inspired the North American initiative. In other words, what we are struggling with, and I'm going to ask you the question to support what Umphra asks. If Barbados is the first country that passed a law in 1661 that said that black people were not full human beings, it would mean that the law did not say that white people were superior to anyone, but that black people were inferior to everyone. And as a result of that, it would appear that every other racial group treat us as inferior. Now, if Barbados, and this is where the question is, if Barbados is 395 years old, and if the history that you and other historians like yourself has taught us that when the Europeans landed here in 1627, that there were no people on the island, but they landed with 10 African people, which they captured from a Portuguese ship. It would mean that the first experimentation of a nation started with Barbados as a black and a white world, a rich and a poor world, and a man's world, because there were no women on the island. If that history is true, what are you all doing, taking into consideration that throughout your presentation, October seemed to be featured very prominently? And that the people of Garvey's movement was so determined to teach and to preach and to advocate. My question is, following up and supporting what Umphra said, what are you all as professional historians doing to help us understand how to get out of this quagmire that we are in? Thank you very much.
Okay, as usual, buddy, with a big question. You see, I don't want to analyze the history in a historical way, but I don't think that if maybe is my was my shortcoming just now. But we're talking about the 1920s and the 1930s. The 1920s in Barbados was a period of brutal exploitation. Barbadians, the standard of living in Barbados was the worst across the Caribbean, you know. So I want people to get that inside their heads, right? Racism was the most acute as well inside the Barbados. You had the dominance of the plantocracy as well. So we're talking about immense struggle. So like today, we have to look and, you know, we have the revolutionists, you say, revolutions don't run in a straight line, but we have to take some of the tangential victories. Right, so you ask, now I'm saying, I wrote the thing there, and I'm saying that, yes, what are persons like myself doing? I think this is self-evident, and here talking, and my whole research agenda is about, educating people, about researching and bringing these ideas to the fore. Hopefully, people will use this information. Some of them will use this information, in your view, wisely, and some of them will keep the information to their chest, and maybe also the information will be used to liberate somebody psychological as well, that something that I can't measure or you can't measure as well. So I think that I'm not like I'm not like the other scholars. I am a Rodneyite. I'm rooted with the people and the struggles of the working people. That is why I study the working people.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Grant. Good night, Rodney. And I believe I can call you that, being my friend, but I also respect you for your scholarship. I'm happy that you've actually spoken about Israel Lovell. I believe that people like Lovell and some of the outstanding Pan-Africanists in the first half of the 20th century, because of the education which we have had, the major contributions that they have made to the shaping and the thinking of the Black Barbadian working class has been suppressed over a number of years. I believe this is a period for us of enlightenment now. And since we now have a lot of Black scholars around us, I believe it is your responsibility and the responsibility of the Black scholars who make it a realistic and genuine assessment of even that history that was distorted. The onus is now placed on you, at least to be out a lot more in the public domain. I know that you are very much a scholar that wants to relate to the working class people. Sometimes you can't get a chance as much as you would like to do it at the University of West Indies. So I am asking that we see a lot more of Dr. Worrell speaking to the people of Barbados, more so than some of the other historians across Barbados. I announce that as a friend, but in this case, I believe it's on the basis of merit. Now, I think Israel Lovell, for me, I'm like David, established the Clement Payne Center, established the Israel Lovell Foundation, and what you have said tonight is enough justification on why these two personalities are very much major institutions of the grassroots, at the grassroots level in Barbados. But I would love to hear some more, what little I know, and I'm sure that many of the people in the audience also would like to know a little more, especially about Lovell's radicalism in the Raspberry arm of the UNIA. I think that is very important. And what was the distinction between the arm that he led in Barbados and the other arms across Barbados of the UNIA? And how his influence impacted a lot on all that occurred, especially in the first half from the 1920s in Barbados right down to after the 1937 uprising.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, my comrade and brother. We used to go to, and we still do it, to St. George's Parish Church, to Lovell's grave. And I remember the former He was the former Cuban and former Venezuelan ambassador. And he said, you know, I went there and I promised that I was going to write something on Lovell. And he said, you know, you historians take forever to write this stuff, you know. However, I did write something on Lovell, and it was published in, a journal. So if John, you can bring that bag there for me, please. Right. So, in an effort to, redress or address some of the deficiencies, right. Yeah, I just want to give you the title, and Trevor would be aware of this work. And the title is Israel Lovell, UNIA President and Political Activist in Barbados, 1919 to 1937. And it was published in the 76 King Street Journal of Liberty Hall, The Legacy of Marcus Garvey. And I published it there because, one, my supervisor was Professor Rupert Lewis, one of the foremost Garveyite scholars. And once his name was associated with the Liberty Hall Journal, was one of the reasons I published there. So I have done, you can say that I have done some work on Lovell, right? Now, the task of a historian is very difficult. So not a lot of information, and if I find it, I will jump and scream about Lovell in the early 1920s. You see that he appeared in 1920 when there was the obvious split between the two entities. Then you see that there's some harmony between the two, Westbury and the Reed Street, Tudor Street branch, because he's sitting at the head table when I think it was Reverend Talbot or had passed through Barbados. You see more of Lovell coming in the 1930s when he's a member of the Working Men's Association. So not a lot is known about his UNIA days, right? Robert Hill is doing a fantastic job in putting out the Garvey papers. But I think the last copy that I had was volume 13, and I'm hoping that there's a volume 14 and 15. Hopefully, they will shed more information. You're dependent a lot on the police records. Whilst there was a lot of information carried inside the Weekly Illustrated and the Barbados Times on the Westbury branch, obvious because Harold Wilson, he was the editor, the publisher of those papers, but not a lot of information. So it's painstaking work. So hopefully, if I stumble on the work, I will bring it to the fore, but I'm willing to talk about what I know about Lovell. And unlike, right, I don't create the facts, right? I follow the evidence as close as possible.
Thank you. So we have Mr. Marshall and then probably one more, and that's it. Sorry, Joy? Oh, go ahead, Joy.
Hello, Dr. Worrell. Thanks for that.
Come forward and speak into the mic.
Thanks for that journey through time. And I have two simple questions. One, I would like you to please expand a bit on the whole question of the school. I find it fascinating to hear that the school, they established a school. And given the era that it was in, and the point that you just made, how oppressive Barbados was at the time, who were the students? Do you have that information? Who were the teachers? What were the curriculum like? And how long it lasted? That just fascinated me. Mm-hmm. And secondly, well, you alluded a bit just now there to my second question, which was, how do you gather this information? But one of the things that you did say remind me of apartheid, and you said you relied a lot on police reports. And I always questioned when I was reading in the papers, police reports stated that this happened. Now you have an oppressive regime, and we're relying on information from that oppressive regime. How then does that really give an insight into the real, like, functioning? Was there minutes? Was there, as you said, the task of the historian is tough. So if you rely on police reports, was there, like, minutes? Was there, like, I don't know. At this time, there won't be anybody alive to really give you a... So just basically, how do you... I just fascinated. Thanks. Okay. Thanks for that travel through time with that information.
Yeah, my sister Joy, yeah, she's special to me. I have two special ladies in the Pan-African, well, I should say three. Yeah, but she and Sister Angela, well, I said three because I'm thinking about my elder sister, Dr. Viola Davis, who is, yeah, special to me. Yeah, Joy, there was a night school, and there was the recognition of illiteracy was very high across the island, huh? Right? And people were working in the fields and at 10 years old and all kinds of things like this. Although they were talking about, in fact, O'Neill spent a lot of time in the 1920s trying to stamp out child labor and these kind of things. So when the school was first opened, I think they anticipated like 70 something people. But after the second or third night of this school, you had about 200 and something students, right? And a lot of these students came from some of the poorest section of society. I think the notion was, if John Beckles was saying, if you don't save these individuals, they'll become, the term was wharf rats or something that was used, right? I guess this was the lowest of the low. The school had, I think, about 8 or 9 teachers. And the names that I mentioned, A.G. Thorne, Smithin, Aldika Griffith, etc. These were some of the teachers. There was a blueprint for UNIA schools. There was a blueprint, and there was a curriculum for UNIA schools to follow as well. And also, the curriculum was also age-based, so you had a section for boys, a section for girls, infant section, etc. Out of the school, you had the Black Cross nurses being trained. You also had the male equivalent to the Black Cross nurses, etc. We can spend some time, talking about the syllabus, but part of it was giving the people things like etiquette, things like skills, history of Black people, history of Garveyism and these kinds of things. For example, the Black Cross nurses would be school and all of what they believe that the ladies should know, etc. Now, I think the police records are very accurate. And the police, if when you read the records, right, the police is trying to, they're at the meetings, and they're saying what was said at the meeting. So, and you don't have time to go, and I don't see that these records are distorting what the individuals are saying. There was a meeting inside the hall last night. 21 persons attended. Alexandrina Gibbs said that a race for the continent, this body is saying this, so you're relying on this information. You try as best to cross-reference this information, let us say, if newspapers are available or other sources. I am not very suspicious of this. You know, maybe if I examine the records at another period. Manning Marble, my favorite historian. He wrote a book on Malcolm X strictly from the FBI records. And this same question was asked of him. And he said, you know, sometimes the most accurate records, right? We can work out when they're distorting the records as well. But, right, so if you look at the records, for example, on the Garvey movement, you see there was a meeting and this body said this. So they're talking about Africa, right? Or there's a call inside the meeting or something like that. Now, sometimes you have to ask questions of your sources. But generally, yeah, you feel fairly confident about quoting these sources. I know Trevor always asks that question as well. So, yeah, go ahead, my brother.
Final question for the night.
I hope not, because the gentleman behind me is lecturer at university. Yeah. And he lectures on Garvey. So can I just say and let him be the second?
Go ahead, of course.
Thank you.
Of course, we'll good take evening, the question.
Good evening, everyone. And to my brother, Rodney, an excellent lecture. Congratulations. I just want to make a few points, and I don't even know if I should ask a question. But we begin with the fact that Ray Joy left off about how do you get material. Now, okay, straight historians, political historians go for documentation. I'm a social and cultural historian. Anybody would know that my work involves talking to the people. And I think it is two, three weeks ago, a lady died at 100 years old. And she traveled from St. John, and I come from St. John. She traveled from St. John to Queen's Park to see and hear the right excellent Marcus Messiah Garvey. And she shared with me her recollections of Garvey. And Arthur Edwards, who attended the same school as I, Lord School, he made a comment which is very extremely important, because in those days, people who saw Garvey, they commented first and foremost on his facial features. He was called a pig. Look at his cheeks, the prognathism, the African, the Yoruba cheeks. For those, he was ridiculed, because you remember his opponent was W.E. Burgard Du Bois, who looked like what? David Thompson. Profile, coloring, etc. So you can imagine those two people agitating for the support of the black majority, the black minority in the USA and throughout the Caribbean. Garvey was ridiculed for his features. I mean, the term ugly as Garvey, ugly as sin. No, people, and anybody who says they did not hear that, do not come from the country, or they have not been examining and listening to the people that I have listened to. Furthermore, a gentleman just died this year, I think it is this year, Etherin Garvey Husbands, a high court judge from Colleton Tenantry, St. John. His parents call him Etherin and Garvey. The priest ridiculed the name. So on his birth certificate, it is E-T-H-R-I-N-E, Etherin Husbands, not Garvey. So I'm just saying that to bolster your point, right? And to indicate that there's much more to Garvey than what the police statements indicate, and much more what we knew. Now, you very kindly mentioned the fact that in 1987, I was part of a group with Viola Davis, Kathleen Drayton, Lloyd Jones, et cetera. We restarted Marcus Garvey movement. And people ask me, why are y'all talking about this ugly black man? And I think that's the point that you must understand about Garvey. Look at those features. Those features on the day, just like Toussaint Louverture, he was not a pin-up movie star. But the point to be made is that Garvey inspired people in Barbados at all levels. There are centenarians today who know Garvey, who saw Garvey, who came to the steel shed and heard Garvey. Furthermore, you look at the colors of the flags. Ghana, the Ghanaian flag, red, gold, green, black, Garvey, the colors of the Rastafari movement, and I'm wearing my Garvey shirt. It's red, gold, green, and black, right? And these are remnants of what people knew and admired about Garvey. Furthermore, you mentioned the landship. The women in the landship were not only encouraged to be in the landship, but they were called stars. From his movement in 1919 in Harlem, Garvey induced and introduced women into his movement, and he labeled them stars, and he gave them a uniform, and he gave them prominence, etc. So the point is that to answer your joy through you, or you through joy, police records and other documentation are useful for us. I have gone long beyond police records. I talk to the people. I go to the people every day, everywhere throughout Barbados, and ask questions about those aspects of our history. And I'm willing to share my material with you. Right. Now, my question to you is, I don't understand. You mean I was talking too long? Oh, no. My question. Oh, before you ask the question. Before I ask a question, perhaps I will not ask a question, but to share this information with you. At the Barbados Community College, in my last 10 years there, 2004 to 2014, I introduced a course called Contemporary Caribbean History, and the subtitle was From Marcus Garvey to Morris Bishop. We started off teaching people. You mentioned Marcia Burroughs. You mentioned Lisa Cummings, Santia Bradshaw, Kirk Humphrey, all of them went through that course. My friend, Monsieur St. Lucia, lecturer. Huh? Yeah, he can tell you. Someone was asking, what are the academics doing? The academics are teaching about Garvey. It is within the cloistered realm of Cave Hill. And I must say that when I left community college, my courses were abandoned. But my good friend here will continue to say something about what is being done. Because he teaches a course in, as you well know, he's your colleague, he teaches a course in the philosophy and opinions of Garvey.
Caribbean political Garvey philosophy.
Right.
Yeah, I know the course well because I'm his second marker and was his second marker for many years. So, I taught that course a year for my comrade as well. So, yeah, I know the course well.
And my small question was, why I didn't hear you say anything about the Garvey branch in the north or branches in the north, but we do know there were some at Crab Hill.
Yeah,
Crab Hill, not just Whitestone, but as far north as Crab Hill, in the parish behind Gardner.
Yeah, but I did mention that, and I'm saying that, and I quoted John Alling, who said that there were branches in Spikestone and elsewhere. Yeah, so but I don't like to dwell on, the Garvey, the boys, the ugly part of that discussion about how people look. I prefer to dwell on the outstanding political thought. I don't think this kind of conversation carried the discussion anywhere.
All right, so definitely final question for the night, and keep it tight. Yeah, yeah. We have one more presentation to come before we close the night.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chair, for accommodating me. I just wanted to add my voice to the congratulations to Comrade Rodney not just for the lecture tonight, but for his entire research program and also his public intellectual work. I think what former Minister Trevor was pointing to was not so much that, was really the fact that Rodney's scholarship is not just bourgeois intellectualism for its own sake, but he has a kind of political commitment to the task, and he also is an intellectual worker, if you want to put it that way. He's an activist and a scholar, and I think that is what distinguishes him from many. But my question is a very simple one, Rodney. You give us a very good, I think you made your case tonight in showing Garvey's impact from 1919 to the present. But you were very silent on the reparations question because you went through all of the different traces, trade unionism, even black theology and so forth. But my question is whether or not that omission was because Garvey was silent on the question or whether there was a contradiction between a demand for reparations and Garvey's own notion of black self-reliance, because some people see the two as contradictory. So I'm just inviting you to reflect on Garvey and reparations and to explain your silence on the topic for us tonight.
Thank you. Very, very good question, but I think the reparation aspect might have been inferred more in, along the lines of self-repairs. Right. For example, we talk about tearing down imperialist statues, right? We talk about our heroes and our sheroes, right? So this is all part of the reparations agenda, right? Not all the reparations agenda is based on looking from the colonial masters, etc. But I agree with you. I think that he was thus far I have seen that he was silent. Although I have seen in the ideas of Sam Garvey, for example, I think it was Frederick Small in the 1930s, and I always speak about this. He said, fancy we saying that we're free. And the King of England is still our head. Now he was saying so in the 1930s. I mean, we were saying that we were free 2 years ago or 3 years ago, but the Queen was still our head of state. So I'm saying that we can extrapolate out of some of the conversations of the Garveyites. And I think I might have done some small work with this in my paper my forthcoming chapter on the struggle for reparations in Barbados. So, we could talk about that. I thank you, people. You've been a wonderful audience.
Thank you very much, Dr. Worrell.
Have a good evening.
Thank you, my brother.
Thank you so much again, Dr. Worrell, for that riveting lecture and for staying on and taking all of those very pointed questions. Our final performance for the night will be presented by Tavon Boyce, and he will be accompanied on guitar by Anderson Griffith. Tavon started singing at the tender age of 3, but it was not until age 10 that he got seriously involved in music. He entered the Richard Stout Teen Talent Competition to further hone his skills and vocal abilities, where he placed second in the 2018 series. That same year, he also achieved gold and silver awards at NIFCA, as well as incentives for the most promising performance by an individual, along with the James Millington Award of Excellence. Tavon is also involved in the Music Angel Senior String Orchestra, where he plays the viola. He's hoping to further his studies and abilities in the music industry, along with being a teacher in science, and he didn't left out by telling me music as well. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, Tavon Boyce and Anderson Griffith doing the rendition of Redemption Song to close this evening's proceedings.
Good evening, everyone. I hope you guys are doing well. You have enjoyed the production thus far. I just want to invite you to relax, sit back, and enjoy this performance that we have for you.
rabbi, sold I to the merchant ships. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit, but my hand was made strong by the hand of the Almighty. Be forward in this generation triumphantly. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever had is redemption songs, redemption songs. Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. Numbered our cells can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part of it, but we've got to fulfill the books. So won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever had is redemption songs, redemption songs, redemption songs. From mental slavery, numbered ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look, look, look how a part of it? We've got to fulfill the books. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever had is redemption songs, redemption songs. Redemption songs, redemption songs. Thank you.
No two persons. Thank you. Persons thought alike. Each one of them had to find out what he was. If they were only cleaning the streets, then they must do so. If they could serve the world in moral thought, then they should do so. They were not too rugged for such a hope. Some of the greatest men in the world sprung from the gutter, and the world would hear about them. Marcus Messiah Garvey. Ladies and gentlemen, The Prime Minister's Office of Culture and the National Cultural Foundation wishes to thank Baba John Howell and the Israel Lovell Foundation, Tavon Boyce, Anderson Griffith, Damani Ree, and Raheem Griffith for the performances this evening. You can give them a round of applause. Our featured speaker, Dr. Rodney Worrell, lecturer, University of the West Indies, Cave Hill Campus, for his informative and insightful lecture on Marcus Garvey's impact on the Barbadian landscape, 1919 to 2019. Thank you, Dr. Worrell. Thank you to our event and technical production team, Riveting Media TV, AccuSounds Inc., IGM Stage Lighting Inc., the Barbados Landscape Association, Mr. Rodney Eiffel, Cultural Office of Visual Arts, Mr. Rhea Garnes, Ms. Michelle Springer, Cultural Officer Research and Documentation, and Ms. Stacey O'Brien, Festival and Events Planner at the NCF. We also wish to thank the members of the media for the coverage of this event, and for you, the audience, both live and online, for joining us this evening. Please join us in the courtyard for some light refreshments. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being here and for joining us this evening. We ask you to remain seated as the minister leaves and her party, and then you can join us in the courtyard. Thank you very much. Have a pleasant night. It was good seeing you.